Good afternoon, everyone. My name is William McDonnell, and it's great to be joining you. I'm joining virtually from Hong Kong. We're here at the moment meeting some investors as part of our post-results roadshow. I've actually spent nearly all my career in insurance, and although I've just had a couple of years in a different field setting up a climate NGO, but I was very attracted to the role of Chief Financial Officer at IAG. Now I'm nearly 9 months in, and I'm looking forward to providing you with my perspective on why this is a great company and why IAG shares are a strong, stable, quality long-term investment for you. So firstly, let me just get onto the slides here. Just a second, I'll show you my first slide. So firstly, we are the largest general insurer in Australia and New Zealand with established, well-trusted and well-known brands. Our strategic focus revolves around four pillars: grow with our customers, build better businesses, create value through digital, and managing our risks. And our purpose is we make your world a safer place. Moving on, we see our business in three parts. So a retail business, an intermediated business, and then the way we fund them through our capital platform at the bottom of the slide. Our retail businesses include household names like NRMA in Australia and AMI and State in New Zealand. We also partner with leading financial services companies like ANZ and Bendigo Bank in Australia, Westpac, BNZ and ASB in New Zealand. And all of this is enabled through our new technology capability that we're rolling out, which we've called our enterprise platform, right across all of our retail business, giving us a distinct advantage. These trusted brands provide us with great scale advantages to support our customers. In home and motor insurance, we have around 25% market share in Australia and close to 50% in New Zealand. Our intermediated businesses also benefit from quality and trusted brands like CGU, WFI, and NZI, the market leader in New Zealand. But this part of our business has distinct products, distribution, and technology requirements. That is the intermediated business. 3 years ago, we set a target of $250 million insurance profit for our Australian intermediated business. And with this now achieved, we're leveraging our underwriting expertise and focus and maintaining the discipline. The New Zealand intermediated business is also performing well, and we expect this to continue. And both intermediated businesses are going to benefit from the commercial enablement program, which is to improve our technology on that side so we can be more efficient and better able to connect with brokers. And critically, we support both of these businesses, the retail business and the intermediated business, with an efficient capital platform, which utilizes global capital and global reinsurance to reduce our volatility. So turning to our FY24 results, we've delivered strong financial outcomes. Our headline numbers really show the progress that we've made building a stronger and more resilient IAG. So we had net profit of nearly $900 million. Our insurance profit was up almost 80%. Our top line GWP, the gross written premium from customers, that's $16.4 billion. And that was up over 11%. And our reported insurance margin finished actually a little ahead of the guidance range that we'd set at the beginning of the year. We declared a 17 cent per share dividend, final dividend that is. And so the total dividend for FY24 is 27 cents a share, which is 80% up on last year. And at the same time, as a result of our strong capital position, we announced a further on-market share buyback of up to $350 million. So to provide you with a bit more breakdown of our business, We now write, as I mentioned, over $16 billion in annual premiums, and this is diversified across various insurance classes. We have slightly over 60% represented by motor and home insurance. And we also provide small business commercial package insurance, rural insurance product, compulsory third party or green slips, and liability and workers' compensation insurance. With all of that, our business is nearly 90% short tail, meaning the vast majority of claims are settled within the period of 1 year. So just continuing on the revenue side, in FY24, so the last financial year, we've recorded top line growth of over 11%, as I mentioned earlier. And this was as a result of strong premium rate increases to counter inflation and counter higher reinsurance costs responding to what's happening with extreme weather. Our growth was primarily driven by these rate increases. And despite this, we continue to have really strong renewal rates across home and motor products. These are around 90%, which are some of the highest I have seen anywhere in the world. And this demonstrates the level of trust that our customers have in our brands and our products. On the commercial side, it's important to have strong underwriting discipline, and that has been our primary focus as we ensure the division can deliver sustainable profitability. So you'll have seen a little bit of volume loss on the commercial side, but that's part of that strategy. Going forward, as insurance premiums are generally earned over a 12-month period, heading into this year, financial year 25, we will continue to benefit from these strong written premiums we had in FY24 that is earning through over the next 12 months. Moving to our underlying margin. So the full year result, which was a margin of 14.5% at the midpoint of our reported margin guidance range. And this is actually up nearly 2 percentage points over last financial year, which was 12.6. In this year, FY24, we increased our assumption for weather and natural perils, and the allowance rose to nearly $1.1 billion. And this is a drag on margin, but was more than offset by the improvement in underlying claims. There was also a small increase in the expense ratio, but that includes this continued investment we're making in modernizing our technology, such as the enterprise platform I mentioned earlier and that commercial enablement program. And also, this has been more than offset by higher investment income from higher interest rates and the spreads we achieved through our investment strategy. So overall, this was a really high quality result. I'll touch briefly on reinsurance, which plays a really vital role in protecting our earnings from, particularly from natural perils volatility. So the chart on the left of this slide, it shows the covers that we purchase from global reinsurers, and it's diversified by counterparty and maturity, the duration of it and form, and it provides a lot of protection to us. So it's now simplified and it's in three parts. So from the 1st of July, first of all, you've got the long-term quota share arrangements we have. These are in orange. These are with some of the largest reinsurers in the world and result in us sharing premiums, claims, and expenses with them. Then we also have this, the annually renewed catastrophe cover for two events up to $10.5 billion. That's the purple. And then we've recently purchased a new 5-year natural perils volatility protection of $680 million, and that is shown in yellow on this slide. And importantly, this long-term protection covers all natural perils from the first dollar of the smallest event. It's a very comprehensive cover. So these reinsurance protections will lower our earnings volatility going forward. And on the chart on the right, you can see that the proportion of premiums from customers that are represented by perils costs and reinsurance costs has increased over time. But with this cover in place, which is 5 years and locks in that cost, this is going to level off which is advantageous. Moving on to investments. This has been the strong investment performance we've had across our technical reserves and backing policyholder funds and also the shareholders funds portfolio. These have been a really important contributor to our results. And the income on our technical reserves was driven by higher investment yields. The portfolio continues to be weighted towards strong investment grade assets. So we're quite conservative with our investment risk appetite. The shareholders funds portfolio also delivered a strong contribution with positive performance across the growth assets, such as equities, and then defensive assets such as bonds. And we actually, in the shareholders funds portfolio as well, we continue to remain defensively positioned. So the growth assets weighting is just about 25% and 75% is defensive. As I mentioned earlier, in FY24, we saw a strong increase in dividends paid, so up 80% on the previous year. And our policy remains to pay out 60 to 80% of our earnings on a full year basis. On capital, we finished the year in a very strong position and we're above our targeted benchmarks. So over time, in addition to these ordinary dividends, our capital position being strong has allowed us to return capital to shareholders. And as you can see in the past, this has included special dividends, but more recently, it's been in the form of on-market buybacks. Our FY25 guidance and outlook reflects our confidence in the business and the momentum that we're driving. So it includes GWP growth of mid to high single digit, which is a combination of premium increases and actually returning to a modest level of direct customer volume growth as well. Guidance also includes an FY25 reported insurance profit of $1.4 to $1.6 billion, roughly equating to a reported insurance margin of 13.5% to 15.5%. And the additional reinsurance that we've purchased gives us like really excellent downside protection. But the upside would be to our benefit if there's less severe weather than usual in a particular year. So to close, our strategy is clear. It has served us well over the last 4 years, ensuring that we remain focused on customers. We've dealt with some issues from the past, and at the same time, we have really invested in the technology and replatforming so that our technology is ready for the future and we're positioned for growth and it's scalable. Going forward, we have four key priorities. The first one is retail business momentum so that we can maximize on the scale benefits of our trusted brands, of our deep customer relationships and this enterprise platform that I mentioned that will enable this. Secondly, we're going to realize the product and efficiency benefits of the investments that we've made. Thirdly, we're focused on delivering sustainable profits and growth in our intermediated business, building on them beating the $250 million profit target we'd set for this year. And finally, we're going to be innovative in our capital requirements. You saw that with the reinsurance deals we recently announced, but we're going to continue doing this and maintaining a strong balance sheet. So to wrap that up, IAG is well positioned for the future. I'm confident in our ability to deliver strong shareholder returns based on our through the cycle ROE target of between 14 and 15%. So Ajita, I'm now happy to take any questions from participants.
Great. Thanks, William. Sounds like IAG's had a good year. So I've got a couple of questions coming through here. So you mentioned reinsurance, which plays a vital role in ARG. You entered into some long-term reinsurance agreements, which I think you touched on in June. Can you talk through them and what it means for shareholders and customers?
Yes. No, thank you for that question. So We entered into two big reinsurance transactions at the end of June. And just for context, participants will be aware that for insurers like ourselves, typically we normalize our results. So we have reported result, but we also have an underlying result. And the difference are two volatile items that we normalize for. One of them is prior year reserve development, and the other one is natural perils volatility. The two reinsurance deals we announced at the end of June tackle these two things. So one of them, it was a comprehensive protection for prior year reserves volatility for all of our Australian long tail liabilities, which is where the majority of that volatility comes from. And the second one, even more substantially, is a very comprehensive protection for natural perils volatility. And over the next 5 years, so effectively, it's like it's got a bit of climate change protection built into it. What that means is that we're very well protected for up to $1 billion of aggregate natural perils experience, worse than the level we're budgeting for. And we've been pricing for, in any case, for severe weather to continue to get worse, which is what all the climate scientists are pointing to, and what insurers all around the world have been experiencing. But from now, this actually gives us certainty of price for that over the next 5 years, and allows us to stabilize the costs for our customers as well. If more severe weather happens, we can manage that cost through to customers. So it's a benefit for customers, but it's also a real benefit for shareholders in terms of volatility reduction. And maybe just one other brief point. We were able to do this partly because we already have a third of our business protected by the whole of account quota shares. That was that orange bit on the left of that diagram. So we only needed to place two-thirds of the capacity in the reinsurance market for this new deal. And also, it just builds on our very long, deep relationships with major global reinsurers and the modeling capability that we have in-house.
Right. So I've got some questions here about global warming, natural disasters. Obviously, that's what we're talking about. Do you have plans further than the next 5 years, for example, put in place to ensure you can continue to insure high-risk areas?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think first of all, it's important that we maintain the relationship with the global reinsurers and the capacity that they provide for being able to, insure natural perils across Australia and New Zealand. For context, the cost of natural perils protection in property in Australia is around 10 times what it is for equivalent property in Northern Europe, because just the weather here is that much more severe and intense. We also do a lot of we share our perils modeling work with local and national government. We do a lot of work advocating for land use planning, because in the long term we've got to make sure our communities are situated in in ways that allow for what is happening with perils, certain mitigation schemes, and for the most vulnerable communities, both physically vulnerable and financially vulnerable. Again, we're engaging closely with government on what the best long-term solutions for those are.
Okay, great. I think we are just about out of time, actually. I was going to ask another question, but we're right on time. So thank you, William. That was a great presentation, and it was really great to hear from you.
Okay, Ajita, thanks very much.